Assalamu alaikum students, how are you all? I hope you are all doing good. This class is a continuation of previous session. In the previous session, we have learnt chapter 8, iteration and recursion. In that, we have discussed about variance and invariance examples. In today's session, we are going to learn about invariance examples, recursion and its examples. Now let's see invariance example. Consider the chameleons of Cromland. This example already we have discussed in the previous chapter itself, and we have discussed the solution also. Totally three different types of chameleons are there: red chameleons, green chameleons and blue chameleons. Whenever two chameleons of different colors meet each other, they both change their color to the third one. In this example, we have 13 red, 15 green and 17 blue chameleons on Cromland. Here the question is it possible to arrange meetings that result in all chameleons displaying blue color? Yes, there is a possibility, only when the number of two types of chameleons are equal in number. But in this example, there are 13 red, 15 green and 17 blue chameleons. So here there is no possibility because no two types of chameleons are equal in number. Let's see the solution to this problem. Let R be the red chameleon, G be the green chameleon and B be the blue chameleons. Now we can model the meetings of two types as an iterative process. A meeting changes R, G, B into R minus 1, G minus 1, B plus 2. Which means when a red and green chameleons meet, they will become blue. So red minus 1, green minus 1 and B plus 2, because these two will be added to blue color. Which two will be added? Red and green will be added, will be changed to blue color. Similarly, when red and blue meet, then they will become green color. So R minus 1, G plus 2 and B minus 1. So red minus 1, blue minus 1 will be changed to green. So green plus 2. Similarly, when green color and blue color meet together, then they will become red color. So R plus 2, red color plus 2, then green and blue will be decremented by 1. So R plus 2, green minus 1 and blue minus 1. Consider, for example, the meeting of a red and a green chameleon. As I told you earlier, when two chameleons of different colors meet together, they both change their color into third one. Here we have taken the example red and a green chameleon. So when red and green chameleons meet together, they will become blue color. So what will be the assignment here? R, G, B. R means red, G means green and B means blue color. So R, G, B is equal to R minus 1, G minus 1 and B plus 2. So red and green will be minimized by 1 and B will be incremented by 2, because red and green color will be changed as blue color. So R minus 1, G minus 1 and B plus 2. Now let's take any two types of this combination, either red and green or red and blue or green and blue. So whatever it is, if we apply these two combination, here will be the answer. The difference in the numbers of any two types either do not change or change by 3. This is an invariant. So first we will take red and green. R minus 1 minus of G minus 1. When we remove this bracket, we will get r minus 1 minus g plus 1. Now, minus 1 and plus 1 will be cancelled. Then, we will get r minus g as the result. Similarly, let us take red and blue combination. Then, r minus 1 minus of b plus 2. When we remove this bracket, we will get r minus 1 minus b minus 2. Here, minus 1 and minus 2 will become minus 3. Then, the result is r minus b minus 3. Then, let's take green and blue combination. G minus 1 minus of b plus 2. Here, when we remove the bracket, we will get g minus 1 minus b minus 2. Here also the same. When we add minus 1 minus 2, we will get minus 3. So, the result is g minus b minus 3. So, this is true for all the three cases. If any two types are differ in number and it should be multiple of 3. Now, let's see whether it is possible or not. However, at the start, we have 13 red, 15 green and 17 blue chameleons. So, what will be the result of r minus g? R value is 13, g value is 15. So, 13 minus 15 is equal to minus 2. So, minus 2 is not the multiple of 3. Then, the next one is green minus blue. So, 15 minus 17 is equal to minus 2. So, minus 2 is not the multiple of 3. Then, the last combination is blue minus red. So, 17 minus 13 is equal to 4. Here, no two colors are differ in number and multiple of 3. Here, we got same number, that is minus 2. And also, it is not multiple of 3. Therefore, all the chameleons cannot be changed to a single color. Let's see another example. Jar of marbles. You are given a jar full of two kinds of marbles, white and black, and asked to play this game. Randomly select two marbles from the jar. If they are the same color, throw them out. But put another black marble inside the jar. If they are different colors, place the white one back into the jar and throw the black one away. If you knew the original numbers of white and black marbles, what is the color of the last marble in the jar? So, this is our question. Let's find out the solution to this problem. This is the diagram shows that how the state changes in the jar marble. So, every time we take out the marbles from the jar, the state changes. There are three combinations, BB, BW and WW. Here, BB means both marbles can be black combination, BW means it may be black and white combination, and WW means both can be white combination. Let's start writing the algorithm. We are using two variables, W and B. W be the white marbles and B be the black marbles. For example, this is a jar of marbles. Here we have four marbles in the jar. Randomly take two marbles from the jar. If we take two, at least two marbles in the jar. This is the condition here. So, while at least two marbles in jar, hyphen hyphen B comma W. So, it may be black or white. First, we are going to take two marbles from the jar. It may be both are black. So, in the case both are black, that is hyphen hyphen BB, throw away both the marbles and put a black marble back into the jar. So, at the beginning stage we have four marbles, then we have taken two marbles from the jar, both are black in color. Here the condition is, if both are black, throw them out but put another black marble inside the jar. So, initially we have four marbles, then at last we have three marbles. So, B is equal to B minus 1. So, how we got B is equal to B minus 1? Initially, we have 4 marbles. We have taken 2 black marbles. Then the condition is, if both are black means throw away both the marbles, then put a black marble back into the jar. So B is equal to B minus 1. Then W is equal to W. Here there is no changes in void, so W is equal to W. Then B plus W, that is total number here. B plus W is equal to B plus W minus 1. So at first we have 4 marbles, at the end we have 3 marbles. So 1 marble is reduced in total. So we got B plus W is equal to B plus W minus 1. Then step 8. Now the second combination. Case both are white, hyphen hyphen WW. So as I told you earlier, if they are the same color, throw them out but put another black marble inside the jar. So here also the same condition, throw away both the marbles, put a black marble back. So B is equal to B plus 1. Here the black marble is added, so B is equal to B plus 1. Then W is equal to W minus 2, because we have thrown 2 white marbles away. So W is equal to W minus 2. Then in total number, B plus W is equal to B plus W minus 1. Here the 1 marble is reduced from the total. So B plus W is equal to B plus W minus 1. Then the last chance, that is step 12, else hyphen hyphen black white. Here the condition is, if both are different colors, place the white one back into the jar and throw the black one away. So throw away the black one and put the white one back. So hyphen hyphen B is equal to B minus 1. Here we have to reduce 1 from black. So B is equal to B minus 1. Then W is equal to W. So there is no changes in white marble. So W is equal to W. Then total in number, B plus W is equal to B plus W minus 1. Here we have to reduce 1 marble from total. So B plus W is equal to B plus W minus 1. Do you understand the concept here? In the above 3 cases, the loop invariant is W, that is the value of white. Here, the property of white is either it does not change or decreases by 2. So, if both are black means there is no change in white. Similarly, if both are different color means there is no change in white. But if both are white means 2 will be decreased from white. This means that the parity of W, whether it is odd or even, does not change. The parity of W is invariant here. So, in order to find the solution, in the problem itself, it describes that if you know how many white marbles and how many black marbles inside the jar. So, what is the color of the last marble in the jar? This is our question. Suppose at the start of the game, W is even. When the game ends, white is still even. Moreover, only one marble is left. W plus B is equal to 1. Imagine that is only one marble left in the jar. That is W plus B is equal to 1. Here, we do not know that whether it may be white or black. So, W plus B is equal to 1 at the end of the loop. Then, W is equal to 0 or W may be 1. We have already imagined that W is even. So, what is the even value here? 1 is not an even value. So, obviously, W is equal to 0. If W is equal to 0, automatically B is equal to 1 here. So, the last marble must be black. Similarly, if at the start of the game there is an odd number of whites, then the last marble must be white. Okay, so this is how we can conclude this problem. Now, we will see the next topic, that is recursion. What is recursion? We have already discussed in the beginning of this chapter. Recursion is nothing but iteration. Recursion is an algorithm design technique closely related to induction. It is similar to iteration, but it is more powerful than iteration. So, when do we use iteration? To repeat the particular statements again and again, we will use a iteration concept. But when compared to iteration, recursion is more powerful because using recursion, we can solve a problem with a given input by solving the instances of the problem with a part of the input. So, it never takes the original input to solve the problem. It takes that input and calls the subsolver to solve the problem with the part of the input. Now, let's see the example for this. Customers are waiting in a line at a counter. The man at the counter wants to know how many customers are waiting in the line. So, this is what the problem actually. Imagine you are waiting in a long queue. So, it's a human nature. We probably think about how long we should wait in a queue. So, we are asking another person in the same queue how many persons are standing in a line. In the same way, the person who is standing in counter wants to know how many customers are waiting in the line. Okay. So, instead of counting the members standing in a queue himself, he is asking the first customer standing in a queue. Okay, so consider there are 5 members standing in a queue. A, B, C, D and E. So, the man at the bill counter asks customer A to count how many customers are waiting in a line. Then the customer A asks customer B for the length of the line. Then the customer B passes the same question to the customer C. And the customer C passes the same question to the customer D and so on. And finally, when the question reaches the last customer in a line, here E is the last customer since there is no one behind him. Once E confirmed that no one behind him. Then he replies 1 to D. Here the D person count himself with 1. Then he replies 1 plus 1 is equal to 2 to C. And C replies 1 plus 2 is equal to 3 to B. Then B replies 1 plus 3 is equal to 4 to A. Then A replies 1 plus 4 is equal to 5 to the counter man. So, this is the concept of recursion here. Then, the next topic is recursive process. What is recursive process? Recursive process is nothing but to split the original problem into various subproblems and find the result for those subproblems, and finally from the solution to the subproblem, the solver constructs the solution to the given problem. Let's see an example. Illustrate a recursive process. Let us represent the sequence of 5 customers A, B, C, D and E. The problem is to calculate the length of the sequence A, B, C, D and E. Now, let's take all the persons, that is 5 persons are standing. No, we can take them as A, B, C, D and E. Here, we are going to find the length of the sequence here. So, we already know that the length of the sequence is 5. That is, length of A, B, C, D, E is equal to 5. Let us name our solver as length. So, length of A, B, C, D, E is equal to 5. Now, the solver length breaks the sequence A, B, C, D, E into its first customer and the rest of the sequence. So, here the first customer is A and the rest of the customers are B, C, D and E. Here, the solver assumes that the subsolver output the length of B, C, D and E. First, we have to find out the length of B, C, D, E, then add 1 and produces the output. which will be the length of A, B, C, D and E. So, length of A, B, C, D and E is equal to 1 plus, 1 is the first customer, 1 plus length of rest of the customer, that is B, C, D and E. Here, 1 is A, so the A person as the person B for the length of the line. Here, this question is a length of B, C, D and E. Here, A will not be in the list because 1 is calculated as A here. Do you understand this? Similarly, the question will be passed to another subsolver here. So, this is the process we are going to be execute here. Now, let's see the block diagram of a solver in the recursive process. So, what is the work of the each solver? Let's see now. First step, receives an input. So, here the first step is we have to receive an input. Then, passes an input of reduced size to a subsolver. Here, the reduced input should be smaller than the original input. Then, receives the solution to the reduced input from the subsolver. So, the first step is to receive an input and the second step is the reduced input and the third step is we have to find the solution for the reduced input, which means a subsolver. Once we found the solution for the reduced input, then the next step is we can produce the solution for the original input. So, this is what the step-by-step process happening in a recursive process. Here is the diagram that shows the recursive process with solvers and subsolvers, which means it specifies the input received and the solution produced by each solver. Now, let's see that. Here we have 5 solvers, that is A, B, C, D and E. Each solver reduces the size of the input by 1 and passes it on to a subsolver, resulting in 5 solvers. Here, the A person receives how many persons are standing in a queue. So, A person reduces the value 1 and passes the question to B. So, 1 plus B, C, D and E. Then, the B person reduces the value 1 and passes the question to C. So, 1 plus C, D and E. Then, the C person reduces the value by 1 and passes the question to D. So, 1 plus D, E. Then, the D person reduces the value 1 and passes the question to E. So, 1 plus E. So, this will continue till it reaches the small enough to the solution. Here, the last solver received E as the input since E is small enough. So, the solver E immediately produces the output 1 to the previous one. Here, D is the previous one. So, D receives the output and he himself added with 1. So, 1 plus 1 is equal to 2. Then, it reaches the previous person. Then, 1 plus 2 is equal to 3. Then, it reaches the previous person, 1 plus 3. And finally, 1 plus 4 is equal to 5. So, the input is reduced 1 by 1. At last, E produces the output 1 to D, then to C, then to B and then to A. So, from the solution to the subproblem, the solver constructs the solution to the given problem. Now, the recursion stops over here. Now, let's see the recursive process for computing the length of a sequence. Here, the input is length of A, B, C, D and E, which means we have to find the length of A, B, C, D and E. Then, the second step is to find the length of subsolver, that is, we have to find the length of A first. Here, the length of A is 1 and plus the length of the rest of the customers. And the third step is we have to find the length of B now. Already, we got the length of A, that is 1. So, 1 plus length of B is 1. So, 1 plus 1 plus the length of the rest of the customers. And the next step is we have to find the length of C. So 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus length of DE. And the next step is we have to find the length of D. So 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus length of E. Here we have 5 ones. Then the next is we have to add 1 by 1. So the last 1 plus 1 is 2. Then 2 plus 1 is 3. Then 3 plus 1 is 4. Then 4 plus 1 is 5. So at last we found the length of A, B, C, D and E. That is 5. So these are all the step by step recursive process to find the length. Our next topic is recursive problem solving. Each solver should test the size of the input. If the size is small enough, imagine if there is only one customer standing in a line. Here the size is very small. Then the solver should output the solution to the problem directly because he or she no need to count any sequence because only one customer standing in a line. So we can find out the solution very easily and directly. Imagine if the size is not small enough. For example, so many people are standing in a line. Here, the solver should reduce the size of the input and call a subsolver to solve the problem with the reduced input. This is known as recursive call. Here, recursive solver has two cases. One is base case and another one is recursion step. Now, let's see the first one, base case. Base case is nothing but the problem size is small enough to be solved directly. For example, if there is only one customer standing in a line, here there is no need to go with any recursion step because only one customer is there. So the problem size is small enough. So this is considered as the base case category. So there must be at least one base case. And the second one is recursion step. When the problem size is not small enough, which means so many customers are waiting in a line, so what we have to do? We have to split the problem into sub-problem and we have to call a sub-solver to solve the sub-problem and assume that the sub-solver outputs the solution to the sub-problem. Okay, and then from the result of the sub-problem, we have to find out the solution to the original problem. Here, this is the outline of recursive problem solving technique. Let's see an algorithm. Solver of input. If input is small enough, immediately we will construct the solution to the problem. Else, if the input is not small enough, find subproblems of reduced input, then solution to subproblems is equal to solver for each subproblem. So, for each subproblem, we will get output. Okay, then we have to gather all the output and finally we have to produce the solution to the original problem here. Do you understand this? Now, let's see another example. The recursive algorithm for length of a sequence can be written as length of S. Here, length is the name of the algorithm and S is the input. So, the input property is S, that is the sequence. And the output property is length of S, that is how many customers are waiting in a line. If S has one customer hyphen hyphen base case. So, if S has only one customer, then that is a base case. Then immediately it will produce the result as 1. Else, if S has not one customer, they have more number of customers. In such cases, we have to call the recursion step. So, else 1 plus length of tail of S, that is recursion step. The next one is, we are going to construct an iterative algorithm to compute a to the power of n. So, a to the power n is equal to 1 if n is equal to 0. So, if n value is 0, we will get the output 1. Otherwise, we have to find a into a to the power of n minus 1. For example, 2 to the power of 5. Here, how do you calculate this? A value is 2 and the n value is 5. So, 2 into 2 to the power of 5 minus 1. For example, n value is 0, which means 2 to the power of 0. Now the result is 1. Okay. In case if n value is 5, then 2 into 2 to the power of 5 minus 1. Here the a value is 2 and n value is 5. So 2 into 2 to the power of 5 minus 1. Here 5 minus 1 is 4. So the power value will be reduced in each step. Here the problem is not small enough. So we have to divide it into the sub problems and calls the sub solver to solve the sub problem. So the input size to a sub problem is smaller than the input size to the original problem. Now let's see an algorithm. Power of a comma n. Here power is the name of the algorithm and the input values are a comma n. And the input property is n is an integer and n is greater than or equal to 0. So the property of n should be an integer and n should be greater than or equal to 0 here. Then the final output is a power n. Then if n is equal to 0 hyphen hyphen paste this. So if it is small enough, then that will be considered as a base case. So it immediately provides the result as 1. Else we have to follow the recursion step. What is the recursion step we have to follow here? That is e into power of a comma n minus 1. Here the value of n will be reduced and it is passed to the subsolver. Okay, so in this way only recursion works. The recursion works in 4 steps. It receives the input first, then the input is reduced in each step till it reaches the smaller one. Finally, the last subsolver produces the output and that output passes to the previous subsolver. So, like that, it reaches the final answer. Let's see now. A value is 2 and n value is 5. Now, we are going to reduce this. Okay, so initially n value is 5 here. Then the question is passed to next subsolver. Then n value is reduced as 4 and again when it goes to the next subsolver it is reduced as 3 and again it goes to the next subsolver then it is reduced as 2 and 1 and 0. So this is called recursion call with the reduced input. Finally n value is 0. Now this subsolver will output the value 1 because 2 to the power of 0 is 1. That is anything power 0 the value is 1. So that the value is written here. Then 2 into 1 is 2. So 2 is written here. Then 2 into 2 is 4. So the value 4 is written here. Then 2 into 4 is 8. Then 2 into 8 is 16. Then 2 into 16 is 32. So 2 to the power of 5 is 32. Do you understand this concept? Recursive process for power of 2 comma 5. Our question is a into a to the power of n minus 1. Here a value is 2 and n value is 5. Power of 2 comma 5. Then we have to reduce the input. How do you reduce the input? To reduce the value by 1. So 2 into power of 2 comma 4. Here the n value is reduced by 1. Again this solver calls the subsolver. Then it written as 2 into power of 2 comma 3. Again, this power of 2 comma 3 written as 2 into power of 2 comma 2. Again, this power of 2 comma 2 written as 2 into power of 2 comma 1. Then it is written as 2 into power of 2 comma 0. That's all. This is the final stage. Then we have to produce the value 2 comma 0. So 2 power 0 the value is 1. Then we have to construct the entire solution. Here 1 into 2 is 2, then 2 into 2 is 4, then 4 into 2 is 8, then 8 into 2 is 16, then 16 into 2 is 32. So this is how the recursive process works. Now let's see the last example. A corner covered board is a board of 2 power n into 2 power n squares in which the square at one corner is covered with a single tile. Now we have to use the triamino. Triamino is a L-shaped tile formed with 3 adjacent squares. Here the question is, cover the corner covered board with the L-shaped triaminos without overlap. But we can rotate the triaminos at any directions as we need it. Now let's discuss the solution here. Let us consider the size of the problem is n. Suppose if the base case is n is equal to 1, here the size is small enough, then the solver should output the solution to the problem directly. So this case is considered as a base case and the result is 1. Suppose if the size is not small enough, then we have to go with recursion step. In the recursion step, divide the corner covered board of size 2 power n into 2 power n into 4 subboards. How do you divide this? By drawing horizontal and vertical lines through the center of the board. Then place the triamino at the center of the entire board so as to not cover the corner covered subboard. Now let's see the solution. This diagram specifies the corner covered board in which the square of one corner is covered with a single tile. Now we have to use a triamino, which is a L-shaped tile formed with 3 adjacent squares. Before this, we have to divide the entire square into 4 subboards by drawing horizontal and vertical lines through the center of the board. Then at the center, we have to place the triamino. While placing the triamino, we have to leave the place which is already covered, because in this square board already one corner is covered. So the concept is, when you do the triamino, we have to fill it with the center of the triamino excluding the one which is already covered at the corner. Okay, then we have to divide the diagram into 4 subboards. Then we can again further divide the subboard into 4 subboards. Then the same procedure we have to do. What is the procedure? We have to place the triamino. While placing the triamino, we have to leave the corner covered subboard. Okay, so again we can divide this board. Here each board is covered with one corner. Now we can place the triamino in the remaining place without overlapping, and we can rotate the triamino at any direction as we need it. After placing all the triaminos, the entire square board will be covered like this. Do you understand the concept? Now let's see the algorithm. Tile corner covered board of size n. If n is equal to 1, then this is a base case. So immediately we can cover the 3 squares with one triamino. Otherwise we have to go for recursion step. Here we have to divide the board into 4 subboards of size n minus 1. Then we have to place a triamino at the center of the board. While placing the triamino, we have to leave out the corner covered subboard. This will be repeated. Tile each subboard of size n minus 1. So this will be continued until and unless the condition gets fails. So this is how we have to write the recursive algorithm for the given problem. Students, this lesson ends here. I hope you understood this lesson. And the assignment of this lesson is given: complete as soon as possible and submit your assignment earlier. Thank you for watching this video. We'll see you in the next video class. Assalamu alaikum.